My name is Mughal Carter-Arlt. I'm a research technology specialist at Toronto Metropolitan University, and I work at the TNU library. By the way, when I say TNU, I'm referring to the acronym Toronto Metropolitan University. For those of you who don't know, we recently renamed, and we're actually Carson University before. So before I get into my presentation, I'm going to be talking about, as I was saying before, the Remastered Exhibit, which is essentially an exhibit that was going on at the Aga Khan Museum, and it focused on XR, which is basically AR, VR. Well, actually, it wasn't much of VR in that, but it was essentially an XR exhibition that I was the lead developer for. But before we get into that, there's a little bit of background that I'd like to talk about. So this collaboration between TNU Library and the Aga Khan Museum started with a Canada Council for the Arts grant. I just have my project team up there to give them a shout out. But basically, it started with a grant for how we can use XR technology to enhance pedagogy in terms of the collections that they have at the Aga Khan Museum for specific artifacts and some of the artworks that they have on display. How can we learn more about those artifacts with XR technology? So this particular example is actually something that we've done with fabrication. So I was sort of brought in to take the astrolabe here, and the astrolabe, it does like a whole bunch of things, but the best, the number one thing that I remember that it does is it was an instrument that was used for how we can tell the sunrise and the sunset of a particular day during the year. It would tell you a particular time because, as you know, as the years go by, the sunrise and the sunset changes. So the thing about the astrolabe is we kind of take it apart and put it together and make it rearrange it with different discs. And so we wanted to showcase that with some of the fabrication work that we have in the lab that I work out of. So we have a laser cutter. And what we provided here is I went to Illustrator and I took scans of each of the pieces from the astrolabe, and I used image trace and also kind of followed it with some of my own handwork drawing as well. And I turned those into vector files that were then laser cut. And then what you see on the right is actually the fabricated replica of that. So there's two versions actually, and the one on the left is the full size version. The astrolabe is actually pretty much as big as my hand, so it's really hard for people to pick up, especially the children. So we wanted to have a smaller version as well. So I made a much smaller version. I can't remember how small it is compared to the original, but we just want to make it a little bit more accessible for children so they can kind of take it apart. And another thing we did is, so everything's made out of acrylic, there's five layers there, but they're all held together with magnets. So just so you can simulate and show how you can take an astrolabe apart in real life, we want to show that you can easily take those apart with magnets. So another thing we did is we took an actual artifact on display, it was a ceramic bottle, and we used a process called photogrammetry. So for anyone who is not familiar with that term, photogrammetry is basically the process of taking multiple images of an object and turning it into a 3D model. And you basically get hyper-realistic, photorealistic 3D models from the actual artifact. And you don't really actually need to know that much 3D modeling to do something like this. You just have the technology, or honestly, Apple, like they have the new iPhone with the LiDAR sensor on them, can do this really, really, really well, and you don't need to know any 3D modeling. So I took this artifact, I created a 3D model for him using photogrammetry, and then I hopefully this is kind of funny. Okay, let me try this one more time. If it doesn't play, that's unusual. Okay, no problem. Basically, in that video, I took the 3D model of that ceramic bottle and I created like an augmented reality instrument. So, using an image target, I had an iPad that was able to detect the image target, and then the 3D model projected onto that image target. So you could kind of rotate the image, and it would rotate the 3D model in real time. And something that's really particularly interesting with this particular ceramic bottle is that when display at the Aga Khan Museum, there are two sides to this bottle, but you can only see one side of the display case. So that's just, I guess, the way they designed, or this is the way they have it on display at the Aga Khan Museum. And even though there are two different sides to it, as you can see from the picture here, I can only take that one side, but the other side has a different artwork on it. But you can actually see that in real life. So by creating a 3D model from it, actually makes it a little bit more accessible in terms of how we learn about the 3D or the actual physical model, because we can't physically replicate the real model, or sorry, the artifact in the museum. And the last thing that I worked on, this is by the way all in relation to the Canada Council for the Arts Grant, so the last thing that I worked on was taking a manuscript or an illustrated artwork from a manuscript and then animating it. And then how this really works. This is another thing that's supposed to show up AR. Okay, well, basically in that video, what I was trying to show is, again, using a mobile device. The image on the left is the image target, and then when the mobile device scans that image target, it creates an overlay of this video. So essentially, there are these arrows going back and forth. It's just to show, kind of give more, a little bit more context in terms of digital storytelling to these ancient Islamic artworks. Oh, by the way, so you'll notice, I hope you can see that at the bottom, but I have some people ask me a lot about how I create these, and it's not a particular app that created this, the animation for this. It was actually Photoshop and After Effects. So if you are curious how I did some of this stuff, just look in the bottom right corner, and that's the actual software that I used to create some of these pieces. Okay, so after working on the grant, the Canada Council for the Arts grant, that's when we were actually recruited to do the Remastered Exhibit. So I was talking about this a little bit earlier during the workshop, but it's kind of funny, this exhibit would not have existed without COVID. There was supposed to be another exhibit that was going on at the Aga Khan Museum at the time, but because of COVID, they had to cancel it because they were getting imports from other artifacts that was coming from another continent. So that whole exhibit had to be delayed and had to be canceled, and they didn't have anything on display for like a whole year. So they called us to try to figure out what they can do with their own artwork. So again, the Aga Khan Museum has a whole bunch of Islamic artworks, and they're in collections called manuscripts. And so I was brought in to create the Remastered Exhibit, and essentially I created four, as they call it, digital interventions. And these four digital interventions, I'll go into them one at a time. The first digital intervention was interactive manuscripts. So the COVID, everyone knows about QR codes now, since COVID, even though they've been around for a long time. And to sort of play off that, we wanted to think of a way of creating a touchless interaction. You know, so you didn't have to press a button to read information, or you didn't have to get too close to pedestal to read information about manuscripts. So we had the QR codes there. Essentially, it was to provide more context on some of these manuscripts. So this interaction here, in fact, I think you can scan the QR code yourself and take you to this exact web page. But basically, if you scan the QR code, it'll take you to the highlighted manuscript. And certain things in this manuscript, for example, I chose this one in particular because in this illustration, there are a bunch of people playing instruments, and if you wanted to hear about how those instruments sounded, normally in a museum you have to maybe press a button, put on headphones, something that you have to physically wear, which is kind of like, we're trying to move away from that post-COVID. So this basically would be the option of going on your phone and listening to that instrument on your phone, which adds another layer of learning, basically, that you don't actually again have to physically touch because it's your own phone. And then I did a lot of animated manuscripts. I think I actually did 5 or 6 in total. And again, I did this with Photoshop and Illustrator, but these manuscripts, they don't, I wouldn't say they necessarily enhance learning, but it's just to make the content a little bit more engaging. So here we have a ship on the left. That's the original manuscript. Sorry, the original, I keep saying manuscript. The manuscript is actually a collection of artworks. to my interpretation on how this would come alive. And again, this is just a, you know, there's a ship and there's different, there are two passenger ships in the water and a bunch of, you know, wildlife in the ocean. So I just wanted to kind of show that as an animated artwork. And this is kind of just the process of how this is done. So again, this is not done through like an application. I think maybe in time there might be some AI generated app that can create these animated artworks, but at the time being, I'm doing it by hand. So and the way I do it is strictly through Photoshop by clone stamping on the background, as or actually as you can see here, this used to be full of two different sides. Like, this is actually, if you remember, there were two armies that I've clone stamped on the map. And so I just kind of Photoshop it out. I have to cut each individual piece out of the picture, and then I use After Effects to create keyframes, and that's how you do the 2D animation part of it. This is just another example. This is my particular favorite. It wasn't even that really complex to do, but I don't know, for me this one was really fun to work on, so I decided to show this one. This is one of, or sorry, two examples of, I think, six that I did. So this one was the most time-consuming, which is digital restoration. And one of the things that I was asked to do was take a damaged artwork and remaster it, or digital restore it. So one of the things that you obviously shouldn't do with art is restore it by hand. Most people discourage it. However, there's some artists who, you know, during the time that they've worked on the manuscript or CO, so I've seen an artwork, they might actually touch it up by hand, which is usually, you want to preserve that artwork as much as possible. So in this sense, I suggest that if we use Photoshop and Illustrator, we can digitally restore the artwork and make it look as accurate as we can using technology, or at least the digital software that we have available to us today, so we don't invasively retouch any of the original artworks. I have a little bit of a process video. I really, really, really hope this one works because this is important. Please don't do this to me. Okay. I'm gonna try to see if I can get these videos to play afterward.
You have it embedded here. So can you play it outside?
I can find it on YouTube, but I'm gonna have to show that one on YouTube because that one is kind of important to show my process. Because a lot of people ask me about that particular artwork and they say, you know, how was I able to make out, you know, because it's so damaged, how was I able to make that out? And how do you know that it's accurate? So let me see if I can find it. Curator of this exhibit, and he was saying that what's going on here is this color royal hunt, and essentially all of these soldiers would round up animals and slaughter them for food. So this is what this is depicting here. So if I just show you this still here, you might actually be able to see there's like goats and lamb and all sorts of animals that are being essentially herded into a circle. Okay, so what I did afterward is, I'm not an illustrator. I actually referenced other folios within the same manuscript. So essentially, as I was saying before, a manuscript is like a collection of artworks. And usually within a manuscript, all of the images look very, very similar. And the reason why is because the artists, during the time they were creating these collections of artworks, they had to go off a master guide, essentially. So they all created a very simple template to reference so that multiple artists could work on multiple illustrations and would all look cohesive in one single manuscript. And so I used the same technique, actually, and I referenced manuscripts that were not as damaged or in very good condition. And I basically traced them out. I copied and pasted. I literally put them down, like fast cut them down. Like if you think about if I printed it all on paper and cut it out by hand and I pasted it onto the paper, that's basically what I did, but in a digital sense. So in this particular artwork, what I was doing here is I was actually clone stamping the whole back so I can get the whole background, a clean background, because if we go to the beginning here, you'll notice the whole thing's been smudged, so you can't really work with what's going on as a foundation. So I was creating a foundation here. So I essentially, you can kind of quickly see me literally clone stamping everything out. And what I mean by clone stamping, by the way, when you're in Photoshop, it's essentially taking references and duplicating those references throughout an art. So basically, again, creating a full backdrop there. I'm just going to skip through. This is a 20-minute video, even at this speed, it's very long. And every time I see like flashing like that, it's because I'm going to different artworks or other folios, and I'm taking, I'm literally copying and pasting characters from those different artworks. So you can kind of see here what's going on. I'm kind of taking a leg and taking a quiver here. I'm taking a sword, or the pants or something. And then I'm also, changing the color of some of these things. So right there I took a horse. Some of those horses are well preserved in other folios. So taking those horses, and then I would match the color based on what I could see in the damaged artwork. So here, it took me a long time to get the right color. And now I'm tracing out, basically I'm tracing out the horse so it gives it a little bit more definition. And then I'm shading it in. So you can see how long just one is taking. Again, this is going super fast, but this took me a really, really long time to do. But in terms of how we learn about artworks, especially if they're damaged, this is a great way of showing how we can learn about folios even if they're damaged. And it even shows the process, like I even talk about, for example, the fact that artists back in the day used a similar technique, but they did it by hand, but now using that technique digitally. So this is things that you can also talk about when you're curating a museum or something like this. Let me see if I can go to something particular. But as you can see, the artwork kind of will develop more and more. This guy's shooting an arrow, I believe, so I was putting his arm in that particular formation. But as you can see, I'm not really doing any drawing. I'm kind of just taking pieces that I found from other folios, and I'm just pasting them in there. I am doing a little bit of drawing to go over like the edges, so that it gives it a little bit more definition. But for the most part, I'm not really doing any drawing. So I'm going to stop it there. It gives you a good idea of that, what that's supposed to look like. So here's another example. This one actually was a little bit more difficult than the last one because the figures depicted in this illustration are a lot more detailed. So this one was a little bit harder to do. And another thing I want to mention is that when I was doing the restoration for these artworks, I was working very closely with the curator of the museum to make sure this was accurate. And there was a lot of things that I was learning too, like if you look at this woman here, actually this woman as well, you can't really tell, but in the damaged artwork, it looks like they're just, they don't have any headdress on or anything else. But when I did the restoration, I didn't have a veil. If you look over here, I kind of created a veil over the woman's head, and same with this woman as well. And that's not accurate, so I had to add that in because all women have to wear veils. So if I didn't have that in there, it would have been inaccurate. So this is, hopefully you can see this okay, but that's the damaged artwork on the left, and then there's the restored artwork on the right. Okay, another thing I'm just going to mention about this one in particular is there's a figure up here in the top left, and to me, when I first was working on this, I thought that these two were just having a conversation. This is, I have to make my own interpretations. Basically, the way it would work is I would do like a week or two of restoration, and I would send it to the curator, and he would tell me, this isn't right, this needs to be retouched. And one thing in particular is I thought this particular person was kind of just leaning on the wall talking to this younger girl. But he's propping himself on a stick, and you literally cannot tell that from looking at this artwork, but he said the way his body is positioned, he's most likely holding a stick to prop himself up against the door, so you can kind of see that here. Hopefully you can kind of make that out, but he's holding like a very thin stick that's kind of going to the ground there. And then the last thing I did was 3D modeling, so I wanted to kind of create a way. Actually, let me give a little more context first. So if you look at the artwork on the left, typically a lot of Islamic art, at least older Islamic art, tends to look kind of flat. There's not really an element of perspective. So you look at the characters in the foreground and the background, and they're the same height. So it's hard to tell kind of what's going on. You know, this is a palace, but it's really flat looking because there's no shading. So this is just the art style of the time. So it's hard to tell, especially, for example, this guy here is like on a pillar and he's calling out, but it's very hard to tell if he's even a part of, you know, the castle itself or not. So I wanted to create a way of, essentially, just by looking at it, you can kind of understand the architecture, and you can kind of understand the artwork a little bit more, so I turned them into almost like virtual pop-ups. So if you think of like a pop-up book, I kind of did the same thing, but used, and here actually they have models of the programs that they use. So this Photoshop, Illustrator, Blender is the 3D model software we use for this, and then I had to use Unity, which is a game engine. I'll show you in the next slide why I used Unity, but basically I took the original artwork, I traced out each of the elements, like what I did when I did the animation, and I turned it into a 3D model, so that by looking at it, just visually by looking at it, you can get a better sense of who's on the forehead, who's on the bottom of the palace, who's on the top of the palace, who's behind the palace, who's in front of it. So, because again, almost as beautiful as the image is, as the artwork is, it is kind of hard to understand just visually looking at it. And so I used a technology called the looking glass, which is a holographic display. So this is a GIF, if you want to pronounce it, of that technology. And so basically what this technology is it takes 3D models and it projects it inside of what appears to be a glass box. So it gives you perspective on 3D models. The way this is done is through a process called lenticular projection. And maybe some of you have not heard the word lenticular before. So I'll kind of, the best way I can explain it is, if you remember Blu-ray DVDs or fancy DVDs, and they had this film on it that you would scratch, and you would kind of see one image to another, you would, you know, hold it in one side, and then you hold it to another, and then the image changes, right? It seems pretty cool. It's a cool effect. That is misrepresented as holographic, but it's actually called lenticular. And so this process, this technology does the same thing but with 3D models, but instead of splitting an image or 3D model into two views, it splits it into 45 views. So when you move from right to left, you can see around the object. So hopefully you can kind of understand that, or at least visually see that with, when I was trying to film this. You'll see that there are figures in the castle here, the palace, that are being obstructed by some walls and being revealed, depending on how you look at it. So again, this is playing off the whole idea of, like, with COVID, how can we look at or visualize a 3D model without having to rotate it with something, like have a physical control. And so by using this technology, the looking glass, you're able to see the 3D model as almost like if it was an actual physical object in a glass box. But you don't actually have to wear physical glasses, you don't have to wear 3D glasses, you don't have to rotate anything, you can just shift your gaze to understand the 3D model. So this is actually my last slide. I always kind of end on almost like a weak slide, but it's really important to stress these in terms of, you know, technology is great and it does a lot of great things for education, but it does come with some challenges. So one of the things is accessibility. So these are questions that I always ask myself, and these are still questions that I don't even really have the answers to sometimes. But when I'm doing my work, I do try to think about these questions, which is, you know, what steps can we take to help make immersive technology more accessible for students with disabilities? That's kind of a good one. Digital equity. So how can we ensure immersive technologies provide equal opportunities for students who might be considered technologically disadvantaged? And what I mean by that is actually ties into the last point here, which is the digital divide. Some students don't have access to these technologies. You know, if you think about students during COVID, the students who had slower internet connections or had poor laptops, for example, might have actually suffered online learning just because of what they were dealt with, you know, the cards they were dealt. And so when we go to the last point, the digital divide, this term used to refer to people who had access to the internet, who did not have access to the internet, but now it's more so a conversation with, you know, what access to technology do we have, like smartphones, for example, that are really old. Sometimes they can't load their pages very well. So it's important to think about these things because by providing these technologies for students, sometimes we're only helping students who are more privileged. And we're not really focusing on the students who are not as privileged. So, because again, sometimes depending on the cards they build, they might not be given the same access to this technology. So, always important to think about these technologies and ask these questions when you're doing anything for education. And that'll be it. So, thank you very much. My QR code is to my LinkedIn. So, I use LinkedIn a lot. If you want to connect with me, go ahead and scan that. And again, I encourage everyone to use QR codes now to connect with people because everyone else.